Welcome back to the morning show here on Arise News.
Ruga, meaning a header settlement in Hausa language, proposed by the federal government of Nigeria, has come under intense criticism. The plan, according to the federal government, is to settle migrant pastoral families and their cattle in an organized place with provision of necessary and adequate basic amenities.
Although the federal government is explaining this as a voluntary project open to states who are interested, there's a growing objection to this process aimed at tackling the herders farmers clash menace.
Well, joining us now to discuss the herdsmen settlement is Joe Nwokedi, a legal practitioner, social crusader, public affairs analyst, and a coordinator of Coalition of Lawyers for Good Governance. Mayor, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you, sir.
Great to have you. What do you make of this ongoing debate? Some have said, you know, it is unconstitutional. Some have said it is land grabbing. Some have said it is planization. What is your own personal opinion?
To a great extent, like I said, they are all right. Because if you look at it from the legal point of view, it is unconstitutional. In the sense, the federal government has no right whatsoever to acquire any land without the consent of the state governors. And state governors don't also have the right to cede any land to anybody, except for overriding public interest, absolutely public interest, where all the members of the public will assess. So in as much as the 1970 Land Use Act vested the powers for ownership of land in state governors, they are holding the lands in trust. Not that they have the right at their disposal at any time to like make use of the land in any form or in any way that they deem fit. It must be for overriding public interest. So now, the point is that the nation of the federal government established this Ruga settlement. Is it for overriding public interest? Does it benefit every member of the society? Is every member of the society going to reap from the benefits that will accrue from the establishment? So can every member of the public assess it, irrespective of tribe or religion, place of birth and everything? So definitely the answer is no. So in that perspective, it is absolutely illegal and unlawful, because there is no place in the Constitution that such powers are like vested on the federal government to do whatever they feel like doing at their own affirmation. Mm. It must be in consultation with the National Assembly. Second issue is that has this been passed as a law? The answer is no. There was no enabling law that backs up this establishment. So in that aspect also, it is also illegal. Assuming it was presented before the National Assembly and it was duly passed and assented to by the president, it becomes a law. Then the federal government can now rely on that. Then it might be a law that might juxtapose the provisions of the Land Use Act. Then the supremacy of laws will now come in. Okay. Which one is supreme? Which one is not supreme?
Let me come in here. So this is what they're saying out there, public talk. You remember the Grazing Act that they pushed in the National Assembly at some point that was rebuffed? Public opinion pushed against it, it was rebuffed. A lot of people say that was the first method they tried. They tried going through the National Assembly, they made a brick wall. Now they're putting in there, this in there. They're also going to be meeting a brick wall because a lot of states are kicking against it. Also, the dichotomy. The office of the vice president came out to say expressly, I don't know about this. Now, what I know about is the livestock plan that we have over a period of time. What is really happening? Is there something we are not hearing or we don't know about?
For me, there is a game plan. There is an undertone. Because like the office of the vice president rightly, posited, if we are talking discussing issues of livestock, then livestock in general, talking about cattle and piggery, talking about poultry farms and all that, then you don't just give them lands. You give them subventions, you give them like something like that will, something that will just like energize them, that will motivate them, like seedlings, like, you know, giving them soft loans, creating like, cooperatives for them, then giving them loans that they will pay at a very interest, low interest rate. Then for a long stretch of time, just to encourage them. And the loan is not going to be free. You just my point now. So you don't just go all out to like say, okay, look, I'm going to like do this for this particular section of agricultural segment. No, it must cut across all the agricultural spheres. And if it's for livestock, like I said, piggery is a livestock kind of business, like poultry farms, and even fishery, you know. You have to, like, take consensus of all these things and then take them holistically and then project and then plan for how to, like, improve that sector. And not just to, like, carve out one aspect, which is cattle rearing, and then settle a whole kind of section of the country in all the states of the Federation. How do you get the land? Like, Section 44.1, like, if I can read it. He said, no, you cannot compulsory, as he said. He said, no movable property or any interest in any immovable property shall be taken possession of compulsory, and no rights over or interest in any such property shall be acquired compulsory in any part of Nigeria, except in a manner or for the purpose prescribed by the law. Prescribed by the law. So this Ruga establishment, is that prescribed by the law? Is there any law passed by National Assembly enabling that? Was that captured in our constitution, which is the ground norm of the society, of Nigerian society? So the point is, like, it is totally illegal and unlawful.
But isn't that why the federal government has now come out to say, we are not imposing this on anybody. It is voluntary. If you want to be a part of it, you apply to be part of the program. And so far, they have 12 states that have shown interest, and they are now in the pilot phase.
Yeah, good and fine. If they're not going to go about it in a manipulative way, because
so
I know,
in that way, it's constitutional.
If it's constitutional, if a state will voluntarily submit to it,
okay.
But even at that, how is it going to be funded? Because we're talking about money collectively owned by Nigerians in establishing this. You have to pass your mind there, because even if states are saying, okay, say look, we can accommodate this, then is it going to be everybody from the states? Because if you want to make it a state project, mind you, it must be everybody from the state. It cannot be a certain section of the people, the Fulanese. It may be if you come to Southwest, say, Ogun indigenous can apply to establish our own Ruga in Ogun State, manned by Ogun State people. In down east, my Anambra people can apply to establish our own Ruga, manned by Anambra people. You can't say because you are familiar with the cattle rearing business in the north, then the Nigerian government will now use money accruing to our federation account, collectively belonging to us as a commonwealth. They now establish something in your own states. Okay. It is still illegal.
Let's make a question for, even in this state that are adopted, the principle and the disposition of federal character in this state. So I'll give you an instance. Bauchi State, the governor was really excited about this. We studied this. And the governor did say, okay, you know what, over 70% of the people in Bauchi are Fulanese, so we will welcome this real wholeheartedly. How about the 30% of people in Bauchi are not Fulanese?
That's also the issue. That's why I said it must be a voluntary, the other aspect of it is that, is it going to be for varying public interest? Can anybody assess it? Can it be said to be serving the general purpose of the people? The answer is no. Like in Bauchi State, for instance, if the governor says, look, I'm going to, like, welcome this idea, it's a noble idea, whose money is federal government going to use to fund it? Is it the money from the tax collected from me and you and everybody from the OIE for our collective commonwealth? Then you're using that money for your own parochial interest, which is also illegal and unlawful. So now, if the governor of Bauchi State wants to, like, embark on that as a project in their state, could I find they can use their own state money to fund it? I said, they will have peculiar nature of businesses in Nigeria. In the Southwest, you have cocoa and everything there. The governor for Southwest can say, okay, look, we want to, like, revive and revitalize cocoa production. We don't have to, like, map our lands for, like, cocoa production in our own states. They use their money and fund that. Southeast and South can say, okay, we are going back to, like, oil. Palm oil, now we are, like, going off oil. Now, no more oil, we know. We are going to palm oil that we are used to before the advent of this crude oil and whatever. What like Mapa Ekas, like, fund oil business? There's something wrong in the state, so government deciding on agricultural project like embark upon. But the point is that let no money from federal government be used to do that.
Don't you think, like many other...
Except if it's going to come as a subvention. Mm. Here, there will be an interest, even without interest.
So, okay. So where is this? You know, we've been hearing 100 billion, 100 billion. Where is this 100 billion going to come from?
That's the issue now. Where is that money coming from?
Well, there are insinuations that the African Development Bank might be involved in all of this. But like many issues in Nigeria, as I was saying earlier, don't you think that there are unnecessary ethnic connotations to this? You've talked about, the federal government did not specifically say this is for Fulani herdsmen. It says headers. And then there's the issue of funding that you're mentioning. Isn't it the same way the federal government has been funding rice farmers in the country? Is there a specific money given to rice farmers that we should not give to the herders?
No, you know, the issue here, we have to draw a clear-cut distinction between the two.
Okay.
Now, rice farmers, cuts across the whole federation. Mm-hmm. Across the whole federation. And not a settlement, not a certain place to settle rice farmers that will involve states that are not into rice farming.
But in the nature of their job, do they need settlement?
No. They'll use their money to settle. They use their money. Every business in Nigeria has a kind of peculiar nature. Talk of spare parts business. They have the peculiar nature. Talk of people selling like Ashebi, Ashoke in Southwest. Has a peculiar nature. They pay handsomely inside the Dumota to establish that business. Because it's a very, very fanciful shop. Some people are as much as 25 million, 30 million. They have their own peculiar nature of doing their business, Ankara and Ashebi and the rest of them. So you don't just say because a business is peculiar in nature that you don't use federal government funds to establish it. The peculiar nature, because they're making profit. It's a profit in business. Mm. I mean, you saw cattle all over the whole abattoir being slaughtered and being sold. They are making profit. It is duty bound. The onus is on them now to devise a means of expanding their business. Just like people selling other forms of businesses in Nigeria, even this your own business. You have others doing the same business. Mm. You work out modalities on how to improve this your business. Some the federal government come and tell you, look, I want to research you at the vintage place in Lagos for you to be at a vintage place like broadcast. No, you worked it out yourself. Work it out yourself. If actually they want to do that, let them ranch. Use the proceeds from the cows they've been selling all over the whole Nigeria and get acres of land to establish. Nothing prevents them from even going south. So look, want like establish if they allow you. Mm-hmm. Like other businesses, if I want to rent shop inside this, let me say, rent office here in Ikoyi, if they don't want to give me office, will I force them?
Okay.
I will force them.
Let's talk about ranching in detail, because ranching is not a new thing in this country. I mean, Obodo cattle ranch we talked about. There was actually an Obodo cattle ranch in the 60s in this country. If we have forgotten in national memory, there was actually an Obodo cattle ranch that had thousands of cattle that were being ranched in that area. So it's not that the name was just manufactured. What happened to ranches? And we have ranches all over this country.
Yes.
Why can't we go back to that model? You know, why can't we talk about that? We move to a quick break now. We'll come back. We'll talk about ranching in general and also look at some solutions. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to the Morning Show here on the Rise News on the last lap. We do have Joe Nwokedi, a legal practitioner and social crusader, as well as a public affairs analyst still with us in the studio. Rufai, you had that question about ranching.
So I have a question about ranching, and we've been able to establish the fact that private people don't ranch. I mean, Obodo Cattle Ranch in the 60s was actually a ranch. I think it was run by USC back in the 60s or thereabout. There was another one run by Odua Group, investment group in Ogun State. Why can't we use that method? And I also want to juxtapose it with, if you watch the presidential chat with Kadaria and the route to last presidential election, Atiku Abubakar, presidential candidate of the
PDP.
The PDP, also brought forward a solution, which he talked about, a paddock ranching system as done in America, and he clearly explained it. Why are we not borrowing a leaf from all of this? Why is it like rocket science today?
I believe in the first place, what actually caused a very big problem in Nigeria is the advent of crude oil. It was a lazy money that we just getting from here and there. Then that now made us like abandon all other avenues of generating funds. Because even the cocoa, the palm oil, the groundnut, the ranching and other agricultural initiatives of the people in the 60s, nothing happened to them. Just because we believe that oil can just give us any money anyhow. Now we're also having an issue that with oil, because you know this time, I mean, so many things will go electronic. So now we have to like go back. And this crisis also coming up, because some people are so much apprehensive of this Ruga issue. And for me, it's like a wake-up call to the governors in all parts of Nigeria. It's a good business. So if it's not a good business, I mean, federal government would not be interested. They would not be pushing it. Now, business opportunity is presenting itself before you as governor of other parts of Nigeria. Why can't you tap into this? Like the Odua Congress, Odua business group that had their own, and a lot of the acres of lands are still there, lying fallow there. Why not revive it? Why not go back to the business and then start producing? Obodo Cattle Ranch, what happened to that? We have thousands of youths roaming the streets, and these youths don't even need much. I have to be sincere with you; they don't need much. I know one that fries Akara in my area, and he's comfortable because he's getting money from there. In a day, he might go home with about 4,000 or 5,000.
And just to put this as a question, if you remember, at some point, we even had a scheme in this country because most of the Zimbabwean farmers, white Zimbabwean farmers, chased out of Zimbabwe. They had a scheme with the Kwara state governor. And Bukola Saraki did have them on sort of like a ranch. What became of a scheme like that?
I don't really know. It's just that we are not serious about these things. We are so much interested in fast-moving business. People can put in money, and within a few years, we have, like, billions in return. That's the most discouraging factor in Nigeria. And we have to, like, stop that, I mean, thinking in that dimension. We need to go back and start growing businesses that people can just do and sustain themselves.
Okay, two real quick questions here. It has been established that some of these herders have unfettered access to lethal weapons. The president once upon a time blamed that on the late Libyan leader, Muammar Gaddafi. Now that we have herders roaming with these weapons and the federal government is saying we are building settlements for them, don't you think that this settlement will curb the insecurity we have? And secondly, what is likely to play out here? What are we likely to see at the end? Because the federal government seems determined. There's no going back. This Ruger settlement is already in its pilot phase in 12 states.
That welcomed it. And my colleague here said something. Said places that welcomed it, and they're like predominantly Fulanese. I said it before, there's nothing wrong in doing business for your people. But the only thing wrong and illegal there is using federal government to fund it. An issue of curbing insecurity, I don't see that happening. If somebody is a kind of prone to like a crisis, no matter however you want to like pacify that person, he will still want more. These Fulanis that we're talking about, or the Hesmen, don't they have lands before? They believe the lands they have are not enough. And they have to like go further to like, you know, explore other places.
But you can't substantiate that.
That's the issue. They want to explore more.
So
when you put them in a Ruger settlement in all the states of the Federation, in near 10, 15, 20 years, do you think that portion will still be enough for them? No. With population increase, do you think that settlement will be enough for them? They do not even encroach on the other land available to even mem and harass and cause crisis on the other people even that hosted them. Because we have to be very, very careful. Ruga for us now might be like the solution. Mm-hmm. But look at it. Population, you place people there, settle them there. They have a certain defined territory. Defined territory that will never multiply. Will never multiply. But they'll be multiplying. Their kids will be multiplying. Their children will be multiplying. And after years, the settlement will not be enough. What will they do? They encroach on the other land and start causing crisis there. So it's never a solution. The solution remains that, look, rent your cattle, use your money, equip your business, and do business like others.
Well, these 12 states have not been made public. We are yet to know which 12 states really showed interest in this. But we have a state like Benue kicking against it, even though the federal government has said Benue is not on the list. But Benue insists that they've seen plans of the federal government trying to build rural settlements in three local governments in the state. We have a place like Taraba, where we are not sure if the governor has accepted, but we have youths who are kicking against this. So what is likely to play out in those scenarios where the governors may have accepted, but the community people, the people are kicking?
And governor will not go on. The land use act is very clear. Governor holds the land in trust. For the people. In trust. He has no absolute authority over the land. No state government can unilaterally, let me use legal language, on his own, go and give land to the federal government. No, you must consult the people. That land is not your ancestral land. Ancestral lands belong to the people that inherited that land. But the point is that the land use act empowers the government to hold that land in trust so that the people that inherited the land will not be a clog in the wheel of progress. If a governor wants to develop the place for like schools or hospitals and other things, that'll be for public interest. So now they are holding the land in trust. That's why even we had a matter in court recently where governor acquired the land illegally and sold for profit making. The judgment came out about three months ago from Badagry High Court. My chamber handled one of the cases for the communities there. So governor has no right to acquire land except it's for absolute interest of the public. Now, if the people are saying, look, Your Excellency, you cannot do this. You can't take our land and give for private business for money generating income for a particular business. You can't do this. Governor cannot go ahead to do that. If governor does that, they will go to court. And the decision will be very, very clear. You acquire this land from these people for their own farms, which is their own business, their own farmlands producing, now giving it back to somebody doing the same farm to make money and from his own profit. Okay. Okay. That's not my point. Thank so it is outright illegal. So I would advise them to go to court. Like the case you raised in Benue. Okay. Benue has anti-open grazing law.
Okay. Thank you so much. Most importantly, the court a lot of people will go to today is the court of public opinion. And we're pushing it to you today. You've heard in-depth analysis here. What do you think? And that's our show for you this morning on Arise News. I'm Rufai Yoseni.
And I'm Adesua Omoran. Goodbye.